Under international maritime law, all of you are dead. You are dead. You've been dead for a very long time. More serious than you can possibly imagine. And no dead person will ever see life, will ever hear life, will never speak of life. You will never make contract with each other, and you shall make no contract or a covenant with your God. And that's the world that you live in.
You are all considered dead and unclaimed by the crown who laid claim and made you their bitch. You cannot, nor are you allowed to speak for yourself, as dead persons cannot speak, and is why you need a lawyer to speak for you in a court. The dead have no rights. This is all based upon ancient ecclesiastical or canon law at its root and core. When you board a ship called a church, which is also considered a bank under maritime admiralty, and embark upon it, the licensed and registered pastor or priest must teach and keep you obedient to the monarch, the crown. Because he who wears the crown, which is the monarch, is the head of the ship called church. He is the king, the lord and captain of the ship called church, and the pastor or priest is an agent of the crown. Maritime Admiralty, or rather Universal Commercial Code, or UCC, is the matrix pulled over everyone's eyes that governs all, because everything has been made into ships on the sea of corporate commerce. Without their one eye, which is money, which is water, all ships are dead at sea and cannot traverse their fictional matrix they created. It's now high time for a concerted universal mutiny.
So sestui qvi equals lost at sea, essentially meaning incompetent or ward, subject to the crown, non-living, corpse, corporation, etc. This is the birth of what we now call the straw man.
The birth, born alive, as a corpse, a ration, corpse, dead person, lost at sea, dead in the water, one.
Why a birthday is a celebration for the birth of a corpse? The birthday is a day for celebrating the birth of a dead baby.
Inclusio unius est exclusio ulterius. The inclusion of one is the exclusion of another. Now, quite often through this presentation, we're going to be looking at words that are defined in different acts. And you need to know that if it includes something, then it excludes everything else. So if it does not include what they are saying, then it is excluded. The Births, and Marriages Registration Act 1995 says that birth includes a stillbirth. Now, we've already said if it doesn't include, it must exclude. So does birth include a live birth? Obviously not. Child includes a stillborn. Does it include a live born? Obviously not. So straight away you're starting to get a picture of what's happening here, because your birth certificate is actually your death certificate.
By definition, liquidation is the termination of a business operation by using its assets to discharge its liabilities, and is also known as the murder of a competitor. The first definition of liquidate is to get rid of someone who may be a threat by killing them, and in secondary terms is to eliminate something by paying off debts. The prefix word liquid gives us the automatic link to the waters of the sea. More esoterically, to liquidate something is to phonetically liquidate them, which is why all ships that sit in their berth have what is called a certificate of manifest that is dated. Therefore, it is liquidated. This would be known as your birthday, where you came through the hips of the mother ship. The anagram of hips is ship, and the mother ship is the moon, which is the egg that brought you to port. the moon of sin that each of us was grown in before being docked in our port by going through the mother's vaginal canal. A canal is a long, narrow strip of water made sail, contract of sail. Of course, this is about selling us into slavery through the womb, which is shown in the English venter, meaning womb, that came from the same Latin spelling, and the related Latin masculine noun, venus, meaning sail, purchase, since Venus represents the clams, money, bucks, used during our purchase. Venus is the Roman goddess of sexual love and generation, and the term venter is why the English language has in commercial terms a vendor or vendors. Humans are sold into commercial slavery, since venal means to be a mercenary, someone who is purchasable or bribable, while the Latin venalici translates as slave dealer. We are hunted in the chase during each purchase. This is the pure chase where they make a clean kill, because to deprive something of everything that they have is to clean them out. They've taken you to the cleaners. In language, a capital letter is one of the large alphabetic characters used as the first letter in writing or in printing proper names, and is sometimes used in writing for emphasis. The Latin word capital translates into English as capital crime, punishment, loss of life or civil rights, and the phonetic of capital turns into cap it all, which is the all caps name that is associated with a human being that is tied to every definition of capital. This is why people are considered to be human resources and receive identification from the government that shows your name in all capital letters, thus indicating that you have lost both your life and all of your rights and have been turned into liquid dated capital.
Watch the movie The Merchant of Venice. There is so much stuff in that trial that people do not comprehend. They cannot take from the living man if he's operating as a Christian with one name. Per the Bible, this goes all the way back to Adam and Eve. Stop thinking about that Bible as a religious book. It's a book of law. Okay? It's recorded law. I told people that basically Leviticus is all about bankruptcy. Look at it. Chapter 13, chapter 7, chapter 11. They all correspond to the bankruptcy codes that we have out here. How come there's no chapter 9? How come there's no chapter 10? Because, basically, there is nothing that would apply to a bankruptcy in chapter 10 or chapter 9 of the book of Leviticus. There's no chapter 1, 2, 3. Come on, people, wake up.
This one, ladies and gentlemen, is also a concordance, a dictionary, thesaurus, a book of banking, maritime. It's actually a very good record of all the things that go along in your world. And I mean go along parallel. It's King James's 1611. Okay, 1611 Bible. What is the Bible? It's a record of banking. Yes, it is. It's a record of banking. It's also a record of the oxymorons that exist in our life. And I did a video on Eve, the truth about Eve. Very telling. Okay. It gives you a record, just like these dictionaries, of the corruption, as well as the solution. One of those solutions is in John's Gospel, chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now, God is not the creator. It's man-made. Remember what I say? When you have a perfectly good word for something, why would you want to create another word for it? Can you imagine another word for stop at traffic lights? That it means something else entirely to a different culture. Halt means stop. Stop means halt. There is uniform language out there, ladies and gentlemen, when it comes to maritime maneuvering. Otherwise, there's going to be a lot of crashes, like car crashes. And yes, cars are vessels. You are vessels as well. Let us look at one corruption that has always caught my ear. That is, let us go forth and confuse them. Did you hear what I said? Let us go forth and confuse them. I thought creator was a singular. I thought God, although it's man-made, is a singular. Now a us turns up. I wonder who us is. And corrupt their language. The tower of, you fill the words, the tower of what? Isn't that a record of the corruption of language, telling you we've corrupted the language so you may not ever construct anything? So you can never come together to agree upon something. It's telling, and it's in your face. Just as you cannot argue with logic and rationality, you cannot argue with the rationality. If you wish to have a gigantic leap of faith, as it were, and ignore the facts that are in your face, then you've got no business watching this, and you should just simply switch it off.
All the U.S. codes, U.S. codes, are basically probate codes. Look up the definition of probate code in Ballantyne's dictionary. You will see it corresponds directly to these codes that they're writing out there. These codes are against the dead. A probate code against the dead. Title 46 is a big probate code for coming out of the system. It talks about it, the age of 25. The Constitution talks about the age of 25, when a man becomes a representative at the age of 25. That's when he becomes a free man.
Early Christian writings, all references to corpse. Writing, Gospel of Thomas. 56 Jesus said, whoever has come to understand the world has found only a corpse, and whoever has found a corpse is superior to the world. 60 They saw a Samaritan carrying a lamb on his way, 10 Judea. He said to his disciples, why does that man carry the lamb around? They said to him, so that he may kill it and eat it. He said to them, while it is alive, he will not eat it, but only when he has killed it and it has become a corpse. They said to him, he cannot do so otherwise. He said to them, you too, look for a place for yourselves within repose, unless you become a corpse and be eaten. The Gospel 01, Philip. This world is a corpse eater. All the things eaten in it themselves die also. Truth is a life eater. Therefore no one nourished by truth will die. It was from that place that Jesus came and brought food. To those who so desired he gave life, that they might not die. The Book of Thomas the Contender. The Savior said, yes, it is useful. And it is good for you, since things visible I among men will dissolve, for the vessel of their flesh will dissolve, and when it is brought to naught it will come to be among visible things, among things that are seen. And then the fire which they see gives them pain on account of love for the faith they formerly possessed. They will be gathered back to that which is visible. Moreover, those who see among things that are not visible, without the first love they will perish in the concern for this life and the scorching in the fire. Only a little time until that which is visible dissolves, then shapeless shades will emerge, and in the midst of tombs they will forever dwell upon corpses in pain and corruption of soul. Woe, you who dwell in error, heedless I that the sun which judges and looks down upon the all will circle around all things so as to enslave the enemies. You do not even notice the moon, how by night and day it looks down, looking at the bodies of your corpses. The Book of Thomas. The Savior said, yes, it is useful, and it is good for you, since the things visible among people will pass away. For the vessel of their flesh will pass away, and when it disintegrates, it will remain invisible things, among things that can be seen. The visible fire hurts them, because of the love of faith they once had. They will be gathered back to the visible realm. Moreover, among the invisible, those who can see will perish without the first love, in their concern for this life and the burning of the fire. There is only a little time before what is visible will pass away. Then shapeless phantoms will come and stay forever in tombs on corpses, in pain and destruction of soul. Thomas answered and said, "What can we say in the face of these things? What shall we say to the blind? What teaching shall we give these miserable mortals who say, 'We have come to do good and not to curse,' and will say further, 'If we were not born in the flesh, we would not know iniquity?" Manichaean. Song 12. Jesus dug a river. The ship will suffer what corpses suffer. Empty. They called it and it heard nothing. Wanderer song. O soul, sleeping. Morning is the truth of the commandments. The dead, the corpses have risen. Asclepius 21-29. And in that day the country that is more pious than all countries will become impious. No longer will it be full of temples, but it will be full of tombs. Neither will it be full of gods, but it will be full of corpses. Acts of Andrew. 24. They sat down, with others, on the sand, and he taught. A corpse was thrown up by the sea near them. "We must learn," said Andrew, "what the enemy has done to him." So he raised him, gave him a garment, and bade him tell his story. He said, "I am the son of Sostratus, of Macedonia, lately come from Italy. On returning home I heard of a new teaching, and set forth to find out about it. On the way here we were wrecked and all drowned." And after some thought, he realized that Andrew was the man he sought, and fell at his feet and said, "I know that thou art the servant of the true God. I beseech thee for my companions, that they also may be raised and know him." Then Andrew instructed him, and thereafter prayed God to show the bodies of the other drowned men. 39 were washed ashore, and all there prayed for them to be raised. Philopator, the youth, said, "My father sent me here with a great sum. Now he is blaspheming God and his teaching. Let it not be so." Andrew ordered the bodies to be collected, and said, "Whom will you have raised first?" He said, "Warus, my foster brother." So he was first raised and then the other 38. Andrew prayed over each, and then told the brethren each to take the hand of one and say, "Jesus Christ the Son of the living God raiseth thee." Justin Martyr. Why do we not imitate physicians, who, it is said, when they get a patient that is despaired of and incurable, allow him to indulge his desires? For they know that he is dying, and this indeed those who hate the flesh surely do, casting it out of its inheritance, so far as they can, for on this account they also despise it, because it is shortly to become a corpse. But if our physician Christ, God, having rescued us from our desires, regulates our flesh with his own wise and temperate rule, it is evident that he guards it from sins because it possesses a hope of salvation, as physicians do not suffer men whom they hope to save to indulge in what pleasures they please. The Epistles of Saint Ignatius. Yet him certain persons ignorantly deny, or rather they have been denied by him, for they are advocates of death rather than of the truth. They have not hearkened unto the prophecies nor the law of Moses, nor even up till now to the gospel, nor to the sufferings which we severally endure. For they have the same thoughts also about us. For what profit is it to me, if a man praises me, but speaks evil of my Lord, refusing to confess that he has borne our flesh? But he that will not assert this has completely denied him, and himself bears about with him a corpse. Now their names, since they are unbelievers, I have not thought good to write. May I not even remember them, until they have repented and turned to the Passion, which is our resurrection. Ignatius to the Smyrnaeans. Chapter 5:5-1. But certain persons ignorantly deny him, or rather have been denied by him, being advocates of death rather than of the truth, and they have not been persuaded by the prophecies nor by the law of Moses, nay nor even to this very hour by the gospel, nor by the sufferings of each of us severally. 5:2. For they are of the same mind also concerning us. For what profit is it to me, if a man praiseth me, but blasphemeth my Lord, not confessing that he was a bearer of flesh? Yet he that affirmeth not this, doth thereby deny him altogether, being himself a bearer of a corpse. 5:3. But their names, being unbelievers, I have not thought fit to record in writing, nay, far be it from me even to remember them, until they repent and return to the Passion, which is our resurrection. The Apology of Aristides the Philosopher. Let us turn now, O King, to the elements in themselves, that we may make clear in regard to them, that they are not gods, but a created thing, liable to ruin and change, which is of the same nature as man, whereas God is imperishable and unvarying, and invisible, while yet he sees, and overrules, and transforms all things. Those then who believe concerning the earth that it is a god have hitherto deceived themselves, since it is furrowed and set with plants entrenched, and it takes in the filthy refuse of men and beasts and cattle. And at times it becomes unfruitful, for if it be burnt to ashes it becomes devoid of life, for nothing germinates from an earthen jar. And besides, if water be collected upon it, it is dissolved together with its products. And lo! It is trodden under foot of men and beast, and receives the blood of the slain, and it is dug open, and filled with the dead, and becomes a tomb for corpses. But it is impossible that a nature, which is holy and worthy and blessed and immortal, should allow of any one of these things. And hence it appears to us that the earth is not a god but a creation of God. The works of Philo. On the Giants. 3. 12. Some souls, therefore, have descended into bodies, and others have not thought worthy to approach any one of the portions of the earth, and these, when hallowed and surrounded by the ministrations of the Father, the Creator has been accustomed to employ, as handmaidens and servants in the administration of mortal affairs. 13. And they having descended into the body as into a river, at one time are carried away and swallowed up by the voracity of a most violent whirlpool, and, at another time, striving with all their power to resist its impetuosity, they at first swim on the top of it, and afterwards fly back to the place from which they started. 14. These, then, are the souls of those who have been taught some kind of sublime philosophy, meditating, from beginning to end, on dying as to the life of the body, in order to obtain an inheritance of the incorporeal and imperishable life, which is to be enjoyed in the presence of the uncreate and everlasting God. 15. But those, which are swallowed up in the whirlpool, are the souls of those other men who have disregarded wisdom, giving themselves up to the pursuit of unstable things regulated by fortune alone, not one of which is referred to the most excellent portion of us, the soul or the mind, but all rather to the dead corpse connected with us, that is to the body, or to things which are even more lifeless than that, such as glory, and money, and offices, and honors, and all other things which, by those who do not keep their eyes fixed on what is really beautiful, are fashioned and endowed with apparent vitality by the deceit of vain opinion. Irenaeus of Lyons. If the corpse of Elisha raised a dead man, how much more shall God, when he has quickened men's dead bodies, bring them up for judgment? True knowledge, then, consists in the understanding of Christ, which Paul terms the wisdom of God hidden in a mystery, which the natural man receiveth not, the doctrine of the cross, of which if any man taste, he will not accede to the disputations and quibbles of proud and puffed up men, who go into matters of which they have no perception. For the truth is unsophisticated, ask Modistos, and the word is nigh thee, in thy mouth and in thy heart, as the same apostle declares, being easy of comprehension to those who are obedient. For it renders us like to Christ, if we experience the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings. For this is the affinity of the apostolical teaching and the most holy faith delivered unto us, which the unlearned receive, and those of slender knowledge have taught, not giving heed to endless genealogies, but studying rather to observe a straightforward course of life, lest, having been deprived of the divine spirit, they fail to attain to the kingdom of heaven. For truly the first thing is to deny one's self and to follow Christ, and those who do this are born onward to perfection, having fulfilled all their teachers will, becoming sons of God by spiritual regeneration, and heirs of the kingdom of heaven, those who seek which first shall not be forsaken. Visits of Eudocia to Jerusalem. Ascetics. They maintain common supplications to God throughout the day and night, to such a degree distressing themselves, so galling themselves by their severe service, as to seem, in a manner, tombless corpses. The Sayings Gospel Q. 37. Then they asked him, Where, Lord? He said to them, Where the corpse is, there the vultures will gather. 19:12-26. So he said, A nobleman went to a distant country to get royal power for himself and then return. 13. He summoned 10 of his slaves, and gave them £10, and said to them, Do business with these until I come back. 14. But the citizens of his country hated him and sent a delegation after him, saying, We do not want this man to rule over us. 15. When he returned, having received royal power, he ordered these slaves, to whom he had given the money, to be summoned so that he might find out what they had gained by trading. 16. The first came forward and said, Lord, your pound has made 10 more pounds. 17. He said to him, Well done, good slave. Because you have been trustworthy in a very small thing, take charge of 10 cities. 18. Then the second came, saying, Lord, your pound has made 5 pounds. 19. He said to him, And you, rule over 5 cities. 20. Then the other came, saying, Lord, here is your pound. I wrapped it up in a piece of cloth, 21 for I was afraid of you, because you are a harsh man, you take what you did not deposit, and reap what you did not sow. 22 He said to him, I will judge you by your own words, you wicked slave. You knew, did you, that I was a harsh man, taking what I did not deposit and reaping what I did not sow? 23 Why then did you not put my money into the bank? Then when I returned, I could have collected it with interest. 24 He said to the bystanders, "Take the pound from him and give it to the one who has 10 pounds. 25 And they said to him, "Lord, he has 10 pounds. 26 I tell you, to all those who have, more will be given, but from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. The Gospel of Marcion, Section 1 Dead Corpse Rising Adva, Mark, IV.1811 And it came to pass the day after, that he was going into a city called Nain, and many of his disciples were going with him, and a great multitude. 12 Now when he came nigh to the gate of the city, behold, a dead man was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow, and a considerable multitude of the city was with her. 13 And when the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her, and said unto her, "Weep not." 14 And he came and touched the bier, and they that bare him stood still. And he said, "Young man, I say unto thee, arise." 15 And he that was dead sat up, and began to speak. And he delivered him to his mother. 16 And there came a fear on all, and they glorified God, saying, "That a great prophet is risen up among us, and, that God hath visited his people." 17 And this rumor of him went forth throughout all Judea, and throughout all the region round about. The third book of Eusebius of Caesarea. He gave up mortality to be food for the beasts, and he himself was forthwith affixed to the cross of crucifixion, in order that to all might become known the nature of mortality. Nor was that which was done concealed by any means, neither from men, 199, nor from demons, nor from the powers which are superior. For it was necessary, that all should take an accurate view of mortality, as in a great theater, when he thus testified of the nature of his human person, and afterwards see death coming in like a fierce beast, and also see why it was that it slew him, and that then the power of life came in after death, and again established for all the victory which is over death, when he had thus made that which was mortal, immortal. The power therefore, which had taken hold of him, viz. The Word of God, left the body for a short time, and it was suspended for a short space on the cross, and became a corpse. But the Word, which gives life to all, became not a corpse. He therefore, thus, attested the mortal nature of his person. This corpse too, of which death had, so, taken possession, was now borne by men, and being worthy of the usual care was afterwards consigned, according to the laws of men, to burial. The grave itself was a cave which had recently been hewn out, a cave that had now been cut out in a rock, and which had experienced the reception of no other body. For it was necessary that it, which was itself a wonder, should have the care of that corpse only. For it is astonishing to see even this rock, standing out erect and alone in a level land, and having only one cavern within it, lest, had there been many, the miracle of him who overcame death should have been obscured. The corpse was therefore laid there, the vessel of the living word, and a great stone held the entrance of the cave. And much did death exult in this, as if, behold, he had now taken even this personage under his power, together with those whom he had ever so taken. But, when the period of 3 days had not yet passed, the same life showed itself, after the rebuke which was sufficient against death. For, if he had risen earlier and immediately, he would not then have been believed to have been dead. But, since he was thus in reality raised, he had also in reality died, and had, for a time, been in reality subject to death, then also did the all-life-giving Word of God evince the hope that is laid up for all men, by means of the second birth of this selfsame mortal body. Philoxenus, Ascetic Discourses, 1894, pp. 1-22. My words behind thee, together with the other things which are written after these. Now as for the man who is constant in reading and remote from deeds, his reading is his own condemnation, and he is the more deserving of judgment, in that while he listeneth every day, he mocketh and is contemptuous every day, and he is thenceforth like a dead man and a corpse which hath no feeling, for if 10,000 trumpets and horns were to blow in the ear of a dead man he would not hear them, even thus is the soul which is dead in sins. And the understanding, from which the remembrance of God hath perished in the death-dealing error of the thoughts of evil things, will not hear the sound of the cries of the divine voices, nor will the trumpet of the word of the Spirit move it, but it is sunk into the sleep of death which is pleasant to it, and although dying, it perceiveth not its death that it might turn and seek life for itself. And as the man who hath died according to nature is not sensible of his death, even so the dead man who dieth by his own will to the knowledge of God feeleth not his death, nor perceiveth his destruction, that he might find a way and seek out an invention of life for himself. The Confession of Antoninus, and Zebinas, and Germanus, and Mannathus, Gr. Enothes. In the 6th year of the persecution in our days in Caesarea. Governor, where with great boldness of speech she made the confession of her faith that she was a Christian, and there also displayed her courage and patience under every kind of torture, and was afterwards delivered over by the governor to be burnt with fire. Moreover, the same judge became day by day more ferocious, displaying both his merciless disposition and cruelty, and he was carried away even beyond the laws of nature, so that he wreaked his vengeance and hatred even upon the lifeless corpses of the Christians, and forbade their burial. And of this same maiden of whom it has been just spoken, and of those who on the same day were consummated by confession, orders were issued that their bodies should be devoured by animals, and be carefully guarded night and day till they should be consumed by birds. Clement of Alexandria. The Instructor. Book 2. And that he reckons such luxury to be sin, is shown by what he adds, "And your sin shall not be forgiven you till you die," not conveying the idea that death, which deprives of sensation, is the forgiveness of sin, but meaning that death of salvation, which is the recompense of sin. "Take no pleasure in abominable delicacies," says Wisdom. At this point, too, we have to advert to what are called things sacrificed to idols, in order to show how we are enjoined to abstain from them. "Polluted and abominable those things seem to me, to the blood of which, fly, souls from Erebus of inanimate corpses. For I would not that ye should have fellowship with demons," says the Apostle, "since the food of those who are saved and those who perish is separate. We must therefore abstain from these viands not for fear, because there is no power in them, but on account of our conscience, which is holy, and out of detestation of the demons to which they are dedicated, are we to loathe them, and further, on account of the instability of those who regard many things in a way that makes them prone to fall, whose conscience, being weak, is defiled, for meat commendeth us not to God." So he adds these most monitory words. Who has woes, who has clamor, who has contentions, who has disgusting babblings, who has unavailing remorse? You see, in all his raggedness, the lover of wine, who despises the word himself, and has abandoned and given himself to drunkenness. You see what threatening scripture has pronounced against him. And to its threatening it adds again, whose are red eyes? Those, is it not, who tarry long at their wine, and hunt out the places where drinking goes on? Here he shows the lover of drink to be already dead to the word, by the mention of the bloodshot eyes, a mark which appears on corpses, announcing to him death in the Lord. For forgetfulness of the things which tend to true life turns the scale towards destruction. With reason therefore, the Instructor, in his solicitude for our salvation, forbids us, "Drink not wine to drunkenness." Wherefore? You will ask. Because, says he, thy mouth will then speak perverse things, and thou liest down as in the heart of the sea, and as the steersman of a ship in the midst of huge billows. Hence, too, poetry comes to our help, and says, "Let wine which has strength equal to fire come to men." The works of Philo. Appendices: a treatise concerning the world but those souls of other men which I have spoken of as being overwhelmed, being such as have disregarded wisdom, giving themselves up to uncertain circumstances, such as depend wholly on chance, of which none have any reference to the soul or to the intellect, but all to the body, which is but a corpse to which we are joined, or to other things even more inanimate and insensible than that, I mean such things as glory, and riches, and power, and honor, and all such other things as through the deceitfulness of false opinions are looked upon as real and living objects by people who do not see what is really beautiful. The works of Philo. Questions and answers on Genesis, 2. But the eldest, for he was not present when he was sold, looking down into the pit, and not seeing him whom he had left there a short time before, cried out and lamented loudly, and rent his clothes, and tossed his hands up and down like a madman, and beat his breast and tore his hair, saying, 17, what has become of him? Tell me, is he alive, or is he dead? If he is dead, show me his corpse that I may weep over his body, and so alleviate my grief. When I see him lying dead I shall be comforted, for why should we bear ill will to the dead? There is no envy excited against those who are out of sight. And if he is alive, to what country has he departed? 18. Where is he kept? For I am not, as he was, an object of suspicion, so as to be distrusted by you. And when they replied that he had been sold, and when they showed him the money which they had received for him, he said, "A fine trade, indeed, you have been driving? Let us divide the gain, let us wear crowns of victory after thus rivaling the slave dealers, and bearing off from them the prizes of iniquity." This is the new song, the manifestation of the word that was in the beginning, and before the beginning. The Savior, who existed before, has in recent days appeared. He, who is in him that truly is, has appeared, for the Word, who was with God, and by whom all things were created, has appeared as our teacher. The Word, who in the beginning bestowed on us life as Creator when He formed us, taught us to live well when He appeared as our teacher, that as God He might afterwards conduct us to the life which never ends. He did not now for the first time pity us for our error, but He pitied us from the first, from the beginning. But now, at His appearance, lost as we already were, He accomplished our salvation. For that wicked reptile monster, by His enchantments, enslaves and plagues men even till now, inflicting, as seems to me, such barbarous vengeance on them as those who are said to bind the captives to corpses till they rot together. This wicked tyrant and serpent, accordingly, binding fast with the miserable chain of superstition whomsoever he can draw to his side from their birth, to stones, and stocks, and images, and such like idols, may with truth be said to have taken and buried living men with those dead idols, till both suffer corruption together. Clement of Alexandria. Exhortation to the Heathen. Chap. I. Exhortation to abandon the impious mysteries of idolatry for the adoration of the divine Word and God the Father. Therefore, for the seducer is one and the same, he that at the beginning brought Eve down to death, now brings thither the rest of mankind. Our ally and helper, too, is one and the same the Lord, who from the beginning gave revelations by prophecy, but now plainly calls to salvation. The works of Philo. On the embassy to Gaius Asterisk, Young's title, a treatise on the virtues and on the office of ambassadors. Addressed to Keyes. The publisher has chosen to use Gaius rather than Young's variant spelling of the name.
124. Yet even these evils were lighter than those which I am about to mention, for when the populace had driven together these countless myriads of men, and women, and children, like so many herds of sheep and oxen, from every quarter of the city, into a very narrow space as if into a pen, they expected that in a few days they should find a heap of corpses all huddled together, as they would either have perished by hunger through the want of necessary food, as they had not prepared themselves with anything requisite, through a foreknowledge of the evils which thus suddenly came upon them, 125, or else through being crushed and suffocated from want of any adequate space to breathe in, all the air around them becoming.
And many who were still alive they took and bound, and fastened their ankles together with thongs and ropes, and then dragged them through the middle of the marketplace, leaping on them, and not sparing their corpses even after they were dead, for, tearing them to pieces limb from limb, and trampling on them, behaving with greater brutality and ferocity than even the most savage beasts, they destroyed every semblance of humanity about them, so that not even a fragment of them was left to which the rites of burial could be afforded.
XX.
132. But as the governor of the country, who by himself could, if he had chosen to do so, have put down the violence of the multitude in a single hour, pretended not to see what he did see, and not to hear what he did hear, but allowed the mob to carry on the war against our people without any restraint, and threw our former state of tranquility into confusion, the populace being excited still more, proceeded onwards to still more shameless and more audacious designs and treachery, and, arraying very numerous companies, cut down some of the synagogues, and there are a great many in every section of the city, and some they razed to the very foundations, and into some they threw fire and burnt them, in their insane madness and frenzy, without caring for the neighboring houses, for there is nothing more rapid than fire, when it lays hold of fuel, tainted, and all that there was a vivifying power in their respiration being cut off, or, if one is to say the truth, utterly expelled, by the breath of those who were expiring among them. By which, each individual being inflamed, and in a manner oppressed by a descent of fever upon him, inhaled a hot and unwholesome breath through his nostrils and mouth, heaping, as the proverb has it, fire on fire. The Meditations of Marcus Aurelius. Book 1. Constantly regard the universe as one living being, having one substance and one soul, and observe how all things have reference to one perception, the perception of this one living being, and how all things act with one movement, and how all things are the cooperating causes of all things which exist. Observe too the continuous spinning of the thread and the contexture of the web. Thou art a little soul bearing about a corpse, as Epictetus used to say. It is no evil for things to undergo change, and no good for things to subsist in consequence of change. Time is like a river made up of the events which happen, and a violent stream, for as soon as a thing has been seen, it is carried away, and another comes in its place, and this will be carried away too. Galen, On the Natural Faculties. Galen on the Natural Faculties Book I. Having come to this point in the argument, I should like to ask those who declare that Erasistratus was very familiar with the Peripatetics, whether they know what Aristotle stated and demonstrated with regard to our bodies being compounded out of the warm, the cold, the dry and the moist, and how he says that among these the warm is the most active, and that those animals which are by nature warmest have abundance of blood, whilst those that are colder are entirely lacking in blood, and consequently in winter lie idle and motionless, lurking in holes like corpses. Further, the question of the color of the blood has been dealt with not only by Aristotle but also by Plato. Now I, for my part, as I have already said, did not set before myself the task of stating what has been so well demonstrated by the ancients, since I cannot surpass these men either in my views or in my method of giving them expression. Doctrines, however, which they either stated without demonstration, as being self-evident, since they never suspected that there could be sophists so degraded as to contemn the truth in these matters, or else which they actually omitted to mention at all, these I propose to discover and prove. The works of Philo. Asterisk on the life of Moses, I asterisk, asterisk, asterisk Young's full title, A Treatise on the Life of Moses, that is to say, on the Theology and Prophetic Office of Moses, Book 1. 38 And they wrought with clay, some of them fashioning it into bricks, and others collecting straw from all quarters, for straw is the bond which binds bricks together, while others, again, had the task allotted to them of building up houses, and walls, and gates, and cutting trenches, bearing wood themselves day and night without interruption, having no rest or respite, and not even being allowed time so much as to sleep, but being compelled to perform all the works not only of workmen but also of journeymen, so that in a short time their bodies failed them, their souls having already fainted beneath their afflictions.
39 And so they died, one after another, as if smitten by a pestilential destruction, and then their taskmasters threw their bodies away unburied beyond the borders of the land, not suffering their kinsmen or their friends to sprinkle even a little dust on their corpses, nor to weep over those who had thus miserably perished, but, like impious men as they were, they threatened to extend their despotism over the passions of the soul, that cannot be enslaved, and which are nearly the only things which nature has made completely free, oppressing them with the intolerable weight of a necessity beyond their powers.
Zechariah of Mytilene, Syriac Chronicle, 1899. Book 5. Book V. And Martyrius of Jerusalem was also one of those who, following Anastasius his predecessor, separated himself from the Antencyclical, and exerted himself greatly to unite the people. And he gained over Martianus, an excellent monk, and this man received him, and admonished the other monks to do the same. But those who did not receive him he expelled. And they say that, after his death, one of his disciples, who was quite blind, prayed to God, saying, If the doctrine of our master be indeed the right one, when I lay mine eyes upon his corpse, let them receive their sight, and he received his sight. It's a good time to read a couple of lines of scripture our friend Pope kept hidden from us for nearly 2,000 years. Beware that no one lead you astray saying lo here or lo there. For the Son of Man is within you. Follow after him. Those who seek him will find him. Go then and preach the gospel of the kingdom. Do not lay down any rules beyond what I appointed you, and do not give a law like the lawgiver lest you be constrained by it. The Gospel of Mary.
Traveling with me. Well, shadows of death.